condensation is an excellent way to make alpha beta unsaturated carbonyl compounds. And those compounds are synthetically useful. Because in addition to having two functional groups, in this case a ketone and an alkene, or in the other case, an aldehyde and an alkene, and therefore undergoing many of the same reactions that you would expect from an isolated carbonyl compound or from an isolated carbon-carbon pi bond, the sum of the parts, right, or the whole, is greater than the sum of the parts in this case, because the presence of these two functional groups adjacent to each other lead to new chemistry. So, certainly, standard reactions of an aldehyde. If, for example, you were to react this with hydroxylamine in the presence of catalytic acid, you would expect to be able to form an ketone. And the carbon-carbon pi bond should remain unaffected. And in this case, since I started with hydroxylamine, it's a special case for forming an oxide, right? So we should be able to form an oxide. We should be able to do kind of standard reactions of the carbon-carbon pi bond. We can react this with bromine and dichloromethane. We could expect to form a dibromide. And furthermore, we would expect that dibromide, you have gone through an anti-addition through an intermediate for ammonium ion. And the carbonyl group should have relatively little effect. It's also possible to hydrogenate by adding H2 gas and a catalyst, say 10% palladium ion carbon. And as long as we keep the pressure fairly low, the carbon-carbon pi bond is much more readily reduced by catalytic hydrogenation than is the carbon-oxygen pi bond. It is possible to reduce carbon-oxygen pi bonds with catalytic reduction, but it technically requires more forcing addition to carbon-carbon pi bond. So we can reduce the alkene in the presence of the carbonyl without affecting it. We can add bromine to the alkene in the presence of carbonyl without affecting it. And we can add hydroxylamine, we can add under acid catalysis, we can add amines across the carbon-oxygen double bond without any reaction of the carbon-carbon bond. If we were to take that compound and react it with an alpha lithium, for example, carbon-carbon pi bond, carbon-carbon bond, oxide as a result. And then propane too as a workout step. To generate reagents to carbon, oxygen, double bonds, and aldehyde, and then lead to a secondary alcohol. If we take that same aldehyde, however, and instead of using an alkyl lithium as our anti-metallic reagent, we add double magnesium bromide. less ionic than the alkyl lithium, which is about makes it a little bit softer. And it can attack the beta position. In the same way that hydroxide ion attacked the beta position. When we're doing the retro aldol, the reverse of the aldol condensation, giving it enoate. This is referred to as a conjugate disorder. Four positions of the extended pi system. The pi system extends over the oxygen and then the alpha, the beta, and the gamma, or sorry, the carbonyl compound and the alpha and the beta hydrogen. The four positions of the extended pi system and the theta position. When we work this up with acid, we could protonate at the one position. Something about what this conjugated pi system actually looks like, which means you need to understand a little bit about the orbitals that are involved here. There are four p orbitals involved here that are out of plane at the sp2 hybridized carbon. And if I treat the board as the XY plane, those would be the PZ orbitals. They combine by the rules of molecular orbital theory. of molecular orbital theory is that if you start with four atomic orbitals, you're going to have to generate molecular orbitals. Right? P for the atomic orbital becomes pi symmetry molecular orbitals. That system will be half whole. There are four electrons in it. And what that means is that pi 2 will be the highest molecular orbital, occupied molecular orbital. And pi 3, which is probably an antibody orbital, will be the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. So if we're going to donate electrons into something, we need to donate them into the empty orbital. This is the lowest energy. So what I need to know is what that orbital looks like. What that orbital looks like is this. Where this relatively large lobe here at the beta carbon. Between the beta carbon and the alpha carbon is a relatively small orbital of the opposite sign. So this started out as the opposite sign on the wave function, and there's another node here. And it's pi 3, which means it has two nodes. Pi 2 would have just one node. Pi 1 would have zero nodes. What we need to understand is that that lowest energy unfilled orbital has a larger lobe here at the beta carbon than it does at the carbonyl carbon. And since we know by the rules of molecular orbital theory that molecular orbitals like to interact with other molecular orbitals of similar size and similar energy to themselves, the larger the lobe on the nucleophile, the more likely it is going to seek out beta carbon as opposed to carbonyl carbon. So small, hard bases react preferentially carbon, while larger, softer bases react preferentially at carbon. And in this case, I'm not talking about acid-catalyzed reactions like oxime formation. I'm talking about negatively charged nucleophiles attacking the neutral pi system. So the softer the base, the more likely it is to do conjugate addition rather than doing ordinary nucleophilic acyl addition to the carbonyl compound. The alkyl lithium is the hardest, well, alkyl sodiums and alkyl potassium would be even harder, but the alkyl lithium is a hard base. The alkyl magnesium bromide is a little bit softer, but not yet soft enough that it reacts exclusively at the beta position. So we get a mixture. It reacts sometimes at the carbonyl carbon, and it reacts sometimes at the beta carbon. If we want to get conjugate addition of an alkyl group to the beta carbon, to the exclusion of addition to the carbonyl carbon, we've got to figure out a way to make it even softer. So, the question is, how can we make an organometallic agent that's our question, right? We've got to soften it up so that we can get it to not react, it got smaller, orbital at the carbonyl carbon, and instead to react at this larger low octane carbon. Think back to first semester when we were trying to do hydride reduction of a carbonyl compound. And we started out by thinking, well, let's take sodium hydride, NaH, which is effectively an ion compound, and react it with our aldehyde. And hopefully this hydride ion would attack carbonyl carbon, and we could do reduction. But that's not what happens with sodium hydride, because sodium hydride is a very hard base. It attacks the hard acid proton, and all that happens is we get H2 gas, and we get an enolate ion. In order to get it to actually react with carbonyl carbon to generate the secondary alcohol, we needed to figure out how to make that hydride softer. And the way we accomplish that is by reducing the difference in electronegativity between the hydrogen and what it's attached to. So now, the electronegativity of hydrogen is 2.1 to 2.2, and the electronegativity of boron is 2, as opposed to the electronegativity of 0.9. Sodium, 2.1 or 2.2, depending on the textbook. This was a big enough electronegativity difference to make this effectively an ionic compound and make the hydride ion effectively H minus at a base. Now we have a relatively small electronegativity difference. There's much smaller negative charge on the hydrogen. This is a softer base. And it will now react with the softer acid. Larger carbonyl carbon as opposed to the hard acid, the proton. And we can do the reduction. And if we have ethanol present as our solvent, remember this one doesn't have to be done in two steps, this can be done in a single step, we can get the reduction. So the key was softening the base. Instead of having H minus, which is large electronegativity difference of greater than 1, we have a small electronegativity difference of now 0.1 to 0.2. Smaller amount of negative charge, larger orbital, softer base, back to softer acid. So what we're going to need to do is we're going to need to decrease the electronegativity difference between the carbon and the atom the carbon's attached to. Carbon has an electronegativity difference of about 2.6 in our textbook. Magnesium has an electronegativity difference of about 1.2, 1.3-ish. What we need to do is we need to decrease the electronegativity difference to make that base softer. It's softer than lithium, right? Lithium has an electronegativity of 0.10. So magnesium is less electronegative than that. Or it's more electronegative than that, and therefore the difference in electronegativity is smaller. But we need to attach it to something that's less, but still more electronegative. And the answer is copper. Take it into a cruciate. So instead of having a carbon magnesium bond, which is quite ionic, we're going to have a carbon copper bond, which is substantially more covalent, and thus much more likely to promote 1,4 fission. And cuprates are readily made if you start with methyl lithium. Simply add it copper iodide, and you use two equivalents of methyl lithium, you will make a lithium salt. So now we have a method by which we can take an alpha beta unsaturated carbonyl compound by cyclopentene by switching your nanometallic from an alkyl lithium to an alkyl cuprate. A dialkyl cuprate allows us to change the mode of addition from 1,2 addition to 1,4 addition, generating a conjugate addition. What else can undergo conjugate additions? That's what we'll talk about in the next video. And you may have noticed that you have a new rate here. It's not necessary to just appropriate the alpha position by throwing this you can trap that enolate with any other reagent that's likely to react with enolate and generate the corresponding